Hi, this is Alex from Groovy Entertainment. Today we got another record to play for you. Today's record is War of the War. So let's get started.
Towards the end of the 19th century, several newspapers in England carried a small account of the discovery of a mass of flaming gas, chiefly hydrogen, originating on the planet Mars and moving with enormous speed towards the Earth. I might not have heard of the gas eruption at all had I not known Ogilvy, an astronomer. He invited me to his planetarium one night to look at Mars through the giant telescope. As I looked through the telescope, I saw the little round planet swimming in a circle of deep blue. Then I saw a brilliant flash of gas shooting from Mars towards the Earth. It was seen rushing eastward, a line of flame high in the atmosphere. The next morning, Ogilvy, who had seen the shooting star, rose early with the idea of finding it. He had not walked far from his home, which like mine was near London, when he saw the spot where the meteorite had landed. There was a large gaping hole in the ground. Smoke was rising from it. The cylinder, which was deep in the ground, had neither the shape nor appearance of a meteorite. Despite the excessive heat, Ogilvy climbed down into the pit to see the thing more clearly. Then he perceived that very slowly, the circular top of the cylinder was being unscrewed. Ogilvy thought that there must be a man inside, half roasted to death, trying to get out. But then another thought surfaced in his mind, that somehow this cylinder was being linked with a flash from Mars. He started towards town seeking help. The first person he saw was Henderson, a London journalist, tending his garden. Ogilvy asked if he had seen the shooting star, and Henderson answered that indeed he had. As the two men walked towards the sandpit, Ogilvy explained that it was something more than a meteorite. It was a cylinder, and that there was something inside. The news about the fallen cylinder spread rapidly. When I arrived at the sandpit that evening, I found 200 or 300 people fighting for the best view. Ogilvy was telling me that he thought that there must be life inside. The end of the cylinder was still being unscrewed out from within, and suddenly, the end fell to the ground. I watched as something stirred within the shadow of the opening. Then something resembling a gray snake coiled up and wriggled in the air toward me. I stood petrified as more of the tentacles emerged. A big grayish rounded bulk was rising slowly and painfully out of the cylinder. In a moment, the monster toppled over the rim and fell into the pit with a thud like a fall of a great mass of leather. Then, another monster appeared at the opening. I ran quickly to the first group of trees I saw. Then I turned and I watched. A leash of thin black whips, like the arms of an octopus, flashed across the sunset and was immediately withdrawn. Then a thin rod rose up, joint by joint, having at its top a circular disc. There being no further movements from the pit, horror gave way to an uncontrollable curiosity, and I began moving closer. Suddenly, from another direction, I saw a small group of men advancing. Their leader was waving a white flag. There had been a hasty meeting, and it had been resolved to try some form of communication with the Martians. There was a sudden flash of light from the pit, accompanied by a faint hissing sound. Then a hump shape rose out of the pit, and the ghost of a beam of light seemed to flicker about it. Blinding flashes of light struck at the people in the surrounding landscape. With much effort, I turned and ran from the sandpit. I left behind nearly 40 bodies under the starlight about the pit. Among them were Ogilvy the astronomer and Henderson the journalist. Exhausted from fright and running, I staggered and fell by the wayside. After a while, I got up and stumbled toward home. Arriving in town, I stopped a group of people and asked them if there was any further news from the sandpit about the creatures from outer space, the men from Mars. And they had no idea what I spoke about. I felt foolish and angry. I tried and found I could not tell them what I had seen. They all laughed at my broken sentences. Finally, arriving home, I told my wife what had happened. I told her that there was nothing to fear, as the creatures couldn't get out of the pit, for on the surface of the earth, the force of gravity was three times what it was on the surface of Mars. A Martian would weigh three times more here on Earth than he did on Mars. But, growing confident with wine and good food, I overlooked one thing. The Martians possessed such mechanical intelligence that they were able to overcome the problem of gravity. Back at the sandpit, they worked on the machines they were making ready. At about 11 o'clock that night, two companies of soldiers arrived and formed a cordon around the sandpit. A few seconds after midnight, a second cylinder fell near the pit. After breakfast, I walked toward the pit. On the way, I met a group of soldiers and told them what I knew about the heat ray. Since I was unable to get near the pit because of the military authorities, I ran home. At 6 that evening, my wife and I heard a muffled explosion and a volley of firing. A violent rattling crash quite close to us shook the ground. We rushed outside and saw the tops of the trees near us burst into smoky red flames, and the tower of the little village church crumbled to the ground. Our chimney cracked as if a shot had hit it. The war with the Martians had begun. We had to get out of here. We would go to our cousins in Leatherhead. We arrived at Leatherhead without anything else happening. I had promised to return the cart. Therefore, after some rest, I left my wife with our cousins and made ready to return. The night was dark, and there was a storm brewing. An hour later, I heard the midnight pealing of a church bell behind me. Suddenly, the clouds were pierced by a thread of green fire which fell into the field on my left. It was a third cylinder. Then came a crash of thunder, and the horse took the bit between his teeth and bolted. I kept control of the reins, and we went clattering along while lightning crackled around us. A thick rain beat against my face as I drove. Soon my attention was caught by something that was moving rapidly down the opposite slope. It was a monstrous tripod, a walking engine of glittering metal striding toward town, smashing aside the pine trees in its path. Then the trees ahead of me were snapped off, and another monstrous machine appeared, rushing as it seemed headlong towards me. I wrenched the horse's head to the right, and in another moment, the cart fell over on its side. I was flung sideways and fell heavily into a shallow pool of water. I crawled out and crouched under some tall grass. Striding by me and up the hill. The monster joined its companion half a mile away. They both stopped over something in the field which I suspected was the third cylinder I had just seen fall. Suddenly I heard a noise under the window. It was a soldier. He told me that he and his men were sent into the sandpit. When they arrived, the Martians had already made the fighting machine. As the gunners got ready for action, the fighting machine raised its heat ray. The next moment, the big gun exploded, the ammunition blew up, and there was fire and death all around us. He laid still, scared out of his wits. Most of the company had been wiped out. He stayed there for a long time. He managed to evade the Martians and somehow arrived at my house. We looked out of the study window. Three of the metallic giants stood about the pit, surveying the desolation they had made. Then they turned and marched off in the direction of London. My brother in London headed for the coast. There he boarded a steamboat with the idea of escaping to France. As the boat left the shore, a Martian suddenly appeared, small and faint in the distance. It was the first Martian my brother had seen, and he stood more amazed than terrified, watching the monster advance deliberately towards the boat. The captain frantically called for more speed. In spite of the throbbing exertions of the engines, the boat made little progress against the ominous advance. Then, a vast iron bulk, like the blade of a plow, came tearing through the water. It was a torpedo boat, steaming to the rescue of the threatened steamboat. The Martians stood looking at the torpedo boat. It may be that it thought that the iron boat was much like itself. As it came close, the torpedo boat fired at the Martian. At the same moment, the Martian raised its heat ray and aimed it directly at the torpedo boat.
With a violent thud and blinding flash, its decks and funnels leaped forward. While the brief battle lasted, the steamboat sped out to the sea. The last thing my brother saw in the distance was the fighting machine examining the wreckage of its victim. Then the captain pointed to the sky. It was a fourth cylinder. When the fourth cylinder fell, I was in the kitchen of a deserted house. The soldier and I had already parted. He had gone off to try to find the remains of his company, and I was heading towards Leatherhead to find my wife. While making my way through the ruins, I had met a priest. He was both terrified and horrified. We were both tired and hungry, and started to look through the deserted houses. The first house we entered had a well-stacked pantry. As we ate and drank, there came a blinding glare of wild green light. Then followed such a concussion as I have never heard before or since. Trapped in the darkened room, we waited in silence until dawn. Then, through a break in the wall, I saw a Martian standing guard over a newly fallen cylinder. This fourth cylinder struck the house and had buried us. We remained in the wrecked kitchen, living on our store of food and dreading each moment as it came. On the ninth day of our imprisonment, I was awakened out of an uneasy sleep by a piercing shriek and a heavy thud. The body of the dead priest lay across the room, and a metal tentacle was feeling its way about the fallen beams. Somehow, I made my way across the kitchen and into the coal cellar. I closed the door behind me. Then slowly, the knob started turning. The door opened, and the thing felt its way around. It touched the heel of my shoe. I was on the verge of screaming. I bit my hand. Then it gripped a lump of coal and moved out of the room, probably to examine it more closely. I lay the whole day among the coal and the firewood, not daring to move. Then thirst overcame me, and I crawled out into the kitchen. It was some time before I dared look through the break in the wall. I could scarcely believe my eyes. There was not a living thing in the pit. I tore open the wall and scrambled to the top of the mound in which I had been buried. The day seemed dazzlingly bright, the sky a glowing blue, and the sweetness of the air. As far as I could see, there was nothing but ruin and desolation. Down the road, I found pitiful signs of the panic that had gripped the countryside when the Martians came. I wondered if I were the only man left alive. Then I saw something crouching behind some bushes. It was a man, as dusty and filthy and as miserable as I. It was the soldier I had seen at my house so many days ago. The last time he saw the Martians, they were headed toward London. We wondered what the Martians would do to us. The soldier thought that they would collect humans and store them in cages, most likely making pets of some of us. I was shaken by this talk with the soldier. He decided to remain where he was, and I was going to London hoping that I might find some news of Leatherhead and my wife. As I walked down the road to London, all about me was a terrible stillness. I was already in the city when I heard a weird howling sound. I wondered at this strange remote wailing. I headed northward, hoping to locate these weird sounds. Too exhausted to continue, broke into a hotel and fell asleep. When I awoke, I ate some moldy biscuits I found and then resumed my wandering. As I walked about, the howling suddenly ceased. Far away, I saw the hood of the Martian giant which had been the source of this strange sound. I ran recklessly towards the monster. Then I came upon a scene that I will never forget. The Martians were dead. Eventually, I realized that they had been killed by the humblest things that God, in his wisdom, had put upon this earth. The Martians had been killed by a disease bacteria against which their systems were totally unprepared. There are no bacteria on Mars, and as soon as the invaders arrived on Earth, our microscopic allies began to work their overthrow. Man had developed an immunity to these germs thousands of years ago. The news of the overthrow of the Martians soon was telegraphed around the world. People started walking back into the silent streets. For hours, I stood scanning the endless number of faces that passed by me. Then, I heard my name being called. My prayers were answered.
I had found my life. It may be that the invasion from Mars was not without benefit. We have learned now that we cannot regard this planet as being fenced in and a secure abiding place for man. And we have learned that, faced with a common danger or cause, all men are brothers.
So that was War of the Wars. So please like, subscribe, share, and comment, and have a groovy day. And our next story will be Adventures of Paul Bunyan. So please like, subscribe, and yeah, if you like, subscribe, share, and comment, have a groovy day. We'll have another video coming out real soon.